All right, y'all. Hey, my name is Troy Flora, and hope everything's going fine with everyone. Let me just check here to make sure that I'm all live. You know how it goes. Sometimes there's that delay. Let me click out, click in. All right. Says connect specified channel stream key. Did not double check stream key. Correct. Oh my God. Of course, now I got. Of course, I got to have this problem. Check stream key. What is the problem with the stream key? All right. It's just go on settings, string key. Let's try to start streaming. Are we live now? See here, I'm not seeing it. Okay. All right, we're live. All right, sorry, I had a little problem with the stream key. I had to fix it, adjust it. Sorry about that, Dave. You know how sometimes you have these technical errors. I'm sure you've had your share of them, but it's all up and running. Today, my name is Troy Flora. I want to welcome to the Motivation and Inspiration page to inspire you. And today, we have one of the best people that I have reached out to recently. His name is Dave Daley. He is the Monster Motivator. He rocks out. So without further ado, let me go ahead and get on this guy and give him a call. Dave. Hey, Dave. Hey.
What's up, brother?
Hey, first of all, I want you to turn the volume down on your secondary device where you can see it, because it gets like a major feedback.
I think I did, or no?
Okay, I can hear you fine now. All right, should be fine.
Okay.
It becomes a nightmare. Okay, I know you can't see me, but that's just the way the program is. I want you to know that you have your logo up above your head. You'll be able to check that out later. There's already some people on, so it's pretty good. Anybody wants to comment, that'd be great below. And again, like I said, my name is Troy Flora from Motivation and Inspiration page. I'm here to welcome one awesome, outstanding motivator and inspirer, Dave Daley. Good morning, or afternoon.
What's up, brother? What's up, man? Thanks for inviting me on. I'm looking forward to bringing the heat and my flavor.
You know, I know it's funny because you're usually the one that that gives the interviews, and so to be, I don't know if I'm the first person that has, you know, in this case, interview you, but you are my first person that I'm actually interviewing in this process. So I want to thank you for that, sir.
Awesome, man. Awesome. Like I said, I appreciate you reaching out, man. I know we've been connected for a while, so a lot of the same mindset, a lot of the same connection. So very, very, very interested to bring the heat.
Okay. Well, I wanted to get into it. First of all, I wanted to talk about this this book. I recently had the opportunity. Personally, I'm like a lot of people. I like reading, but I'll be honest with you, I prefer. I'm in my car a lot, so I prefer audiobooks. I don't just sit there to get there. I like to learn, get some education, get some inspiration, try to get some knowledge from A to B. And for years, I've delivered pizzas, so I like to just get that knowledge while I'm sitting there riding around. And I don't know if you're the same way, because you have to travel to different areas. Let's start with that. Do you like audiobooks? Do you like those things that give you the knowledge? Is that what kind of got you started?
Yeah, you know, I definitely am a big fan of audiobooks for a few reasons. Well, first, let me just let you guys know that about a month and a half ago, we finally got Knockout Fear in the first round on audio. So, and I think Troy might have got a copy of that. But the reason I like audiobooks is simply because I am on the go. And I always consider, like, however your method of travel, whether it's car, vehicle, plane, train, I don't care what it is, that should be your university on wheels. So the audiobooks allow that to happen. YouTube with the interviews and the podcast allow that to happen. And the other reason I like audio is because I learn, and a lot of people learn, in repetition. So when you listen to it over and over and over again, you're going to pick up things that you didn't pick up before, simply because your level of awareness has now moved up another notch. You can do the same thing with books, but for me, I love just embedding it in my subconscious through the audio.
That's awesome. You know, I listened to your audiobook, and it took me a couple of days, and you have a message that you repeat over and over again. Some of the chapters almost seem like it's the same chapter. Not that that's a bad thing. I just seem. Did you intentionally do that to get to reiterate the message of your book, or is that just you just want to really push drive that message home?
You know, nothing was. I just ran with it like I do with everything, man, and everything I share in my book and my programs and Monster Motivator TV, all my message, all the outlets of my messages really come back to one thing. Comes back to, or actually a few things, personal development, and I am sharing with you things that have worked for me over the last 20-something years of being an entrepreneur and building multiple businesses and selling them and falling down and getting back up and having failures and getting back up, having successes and learning how to run with that and build on it. So I always tell people a few things, Troy. When it comes to personal development, when it comes to self-help, if anybody out there says that they created something new, run. Don't look back. This all goes back to antiquity. This all goes back to the beginning of time. I just happen to share it in my flavor and share things and processes and formulas that have helped me in the real world. And they're all things that I implemented. And sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. So that's what you hear in that book.
Oh, man, it's fantastic. One thing I really love about it is you have some really good key stories in it, and we're going to dive into those a little bit and some things that go be a little bit beyond and outside of those key stories. Why don't you go ahead and just for the people who haven't yet seen it, maybe at the beginning of how you got started. You're talking about you were looking through the paper, and if you could just recap that for those of the situation, how you didn't have a job, you were a heavy laborer, and just summarize that up real quick.
Well, I'll even go. We'll even go back a little bit further, so it kind of gives a little bit of a platform. So we'll go. We'll take them all the way back to the Little Monster Motivator. How about that?
Okay.
So, you know, first of all, let me just say I'm not even supposed to be here, because why I say that is it did not start out very well at all. It did not start out looking very successful at all. Left back in the second grade. Diagnosed with ADD, said I had a learning disorder, never graduated high school, and at 19, I'm sitting in a jail cell looking at 8 to 10 if things don't go my way. So to say that it started out a little rough is an understatement. And, you know, all those years struggling in school, you know, I was told, don't expect a lot out of yourself. Don't, you know, because you can't learn in this cookie cutter mode, because you can't learn in this actual, it's hard for you to learn in this classroom environment. And, you know, you buy into that, especially when you're young and you, you're trying to figure out what's wrong. How come you feel different? Why is this? Why is that? And what it really boiled down to was I realized when I became an adult and I became to expand, and, you know, I share this in my keynote, there was a gentleman that came in my life, his name's Tommy. And he showed me that there's so many more options for me than what I thought, than just being a construction laborer, just being a physical guy. And now when I look back, Troy, if I could just give you a one-sentence answer, it would be, thank God. I thank God every day that EQ trumps IQ in the real world.
Absolutely, absolutely. I was going to dive in now. I had forgot. I'm trying to write down a few questions. I want to make sure I didn't forget. And this was one of them I wanted to talk about. You said you're diagnosed with ADHD? Hell, I get all messed up on the acronyms.
Who knows? Who cares? They got more titles for this nonsense to give you to justify people's positions, justify people's titles, and to pump you full of drugs. You know what? At the end of the day, the results and the reality don't lie. Step back. Look into some of the backgrounds of the most successful entrepreneurs out there, people that changed the world, like Steve Jobs, Richard Branson, and Gary Vee. Look at these people and what they did in the traditional classroom environment, and then look what they did in the real world. And that's the real, right? That's the real. Instead of trying to judge and score everyone on the masses, you know, maybe they need to step back and start to individualize and start to customize and start to really bring out the creative juices of these entrepreneurs instead of trying to tell them that you need to be sheep instead of a wolf. You need to be sheep instead of a lion.
Yeah, you know I talk about this all the time about the whole school system, the educational system, and we could probably go back and forth, and unfortunately there's not really a better system available, but I talk about this. I say in the past they used to have like mentorships, like complete mentorships, you know, like hundreds of years ago it'd be like your kid would leave the family entirely, live with, you know, whatever, a blacksmith. They would learn the blacksmith's trade, but it wouldn't just be learn the blacksmith's trade. They would learn the whole life of a blacksmith, how the blacksmith does business, how the blacksmith conducts with the community. Like, they would become like that mentor. But nowadays, we only have teachers, and teachers aren't exactly the same as mentors. They're not. They teach you information, but to push you along, they don't really, you know, someone who you want to be like. You just want to get the information. Would you not agree with that?
I mean, you know, listen, I think they're missing a... I think way too much is put on stuff that has nothing to do with the real world instead of really focusing on, like, financials, balancing checkbooks, P&L statements, mm-hmm. and then the branding and the marketing part of it, right? Because there's so many people. And then really getting down to the real core of things and understanding that how you become successful – at the end of the day, it's really simple. It's just not always easy for people. But how you become successful is – identifying your strengths and enhancing your weaknesses. So if you're not a bookkeeper, if you're not an accountant, if you're not a guy or a girl behind the scenes, then either partner or bring on people that are strong in that regard. So now you can run with your strengths. If you're that front person, if you're that brander, if you're that marketer, that's how you create success. You create an alliance. You create a team that enhances your weaknesses. And then you can run with your strengths. And that's leadership 101. And I'm talking about leadership of your own life. Even if you're not an entrepreneur, you're leading a family, you're leading a company, you're leading the vision of a company, or you're simply leading yourself. Does that make sense, Troy?
Absolutely, absolutely. I just want to, before we move on, I just want to drive something home with this. I once watched the interview. It had Damon John, the guy that created FUBU.
Yeah.
Shark Tank, one also an awesome individual. And, you know, he was talking about this, and he was asked in an interview because I think he had some kind of learning disability as well when he was younger. And they talked about it. They talked about how Richard Branson had dyslexia. You know, Grant Cardone always talked about how he had all kind of high-definition ADHD or something when he was a kid. And they asked Damon John about this, and his response was, he said maybe that's why they become such a success, because that the fact that school is not good for them. The education, the system that's already in place can't work for people like you, like me. Like, they have such a hard time with it. So they say, well, if I can't do it, I won't do it, and I'll do something else. And since they start driving against the something else, they find the success because they're going against what the standard, get a job, get married, you know, go to work. They say, well, I can't do that. I got to go find my own creation and start creating it. And I want to know what your thoughts of on that is.
Oh, he's 100%. He's 100% on. And I actually heard an interview with him. I think he was on Lewis Howes' podcast, and he said that 4 out of the 6 sharks on Shark Tank are dyslexic.
Wow.
So, yeah. So, you know, at the end of the day, here's the bottom line, really what it boils down to, is the scorecard, the scoring system is old, outdated, and it doesn't hold a whole lot of water in the real world, and that's just the real, man.
Yeah. So I want to drive this point home because there's so many people out there, so many people that might watch this in the replay video or on YouTube, or they might come across this later, and you find so many things that people say, man, how can I do this? How can I get out of this struggle? But the truth is, it's all a mental thing. It's all in the mindset that you can get out of trouble. You know, a little known fact about me, Dave, I don't know if I told you this before, but, you know, I was a premature baby. I was born 7 months. I could literally, my head was here. You can't see, but I'm pointing at my hand. My head is here, and my butt was at the bottom of your palm, and my legs dangled over. I was 7 months old. I was a premature baby. I had problems, complications, a lot of asthma when I was a kid. As I grew up, funny thing was, to me, education was always a struggle. I was a kid that was always studying like 3 hours to learn something that would take somebody else 10 minutes. And it's always been a struggle for me education-wise. Funny enough, in fact, I had such a struggle and I was so depressed about it my senior year of high school that midway through my senior year of high school, you know, I was struggling to get C's and, you know, between B's and D's, but I was average, but I was struggling hard at it, depressed, you know? So we went to the school system and asked, you know, for help, you know, try to get these help programs. Now, they have a lot more programs available now than they did back then. But, you know, so I did all this testing, you know, I went to the hospital, did all these testing with my brain and everything. And basically, because I was a premature kid, they said my brain would never be fully developed in my entire life. I would never have the full capacity of an average person just because of my beginnings, the way it just started out. Like that's why sometimes I have so much trouble with struggling with stuff. And they wanted to put me into, I don't even want to say the word, but with the mentally challenged kids, I don't even know if that's the politically correct word to use now, but the kids at the end of the hall, the ones you see that everybody laughs at, make jokes of, they wanted to move me from my regular classes and put me into that course during my senior year. My mom gave the school board hell, and I ended up graduating normal and moving on, and now I'm in a college program where I've gotten straight A's, but I still struggle. And I think that, you know, maybe it's the struggle that makes the success. And I was just want to know, do you think that it is because of the struggle that you can build that struggle muscle, if you will, and get to the success level?
100%, man. Struggle equals strength all day long. And if you're not sure, if anybody's not sure about that, just look at nature. That's why the mom bird watches her baby peck its way out of the shell when that mom bird can actually break that shell in about 2 seconds. But nature reminds that mom bird that in order for that baby to become strong enough and succeed on its own eventually, it has to learn that struggle equals strength. So just always go back to nature if you're not sure. And that, at the end of the day, that's the truth. And, you know, we had levels in classes as well. There was level 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. I was in level, they put me in level 4, so there was only a handful of kids. Two of my best friends that I grew up with, I still really close with, were in those level classes as well. I didn't graduate high school. I walked out. They graduated by the skin of their teeth. I mean, the skin of their teeth. They both operate multi-million dollar businesses. My one buddy's got a $9 million business. So at the end of the day, the scorecard doesn't mean a whole lot if you don't allow it to mean a whole lot.
Okay. All right, we're going to get past this topic and move on to the next. Now, I noticed that in your book, you had a really awesome inspirational story where you became from a laborer and you tried something where they said they were going to teach you to become a fax machine and copier salesman. And you said back then they took you to the top floor. And the way the audiobook reads is that basically you turn around and what's the guy's name? Mike? He was gone and left you standing there alone. I'd like to hear more about that insight.
Yeah, you know, I share this in my keynote. So I was a laborer. This was back in the early 90s, and we were in a major, major recession, kind of like we were in 2008, 2009, and there was no work going on. I was in construction labor. I'm from the East Coast. I'm from Jersey, Philly area. So I was in the ironworkers union, the laborers. So anyway, there was no work going on, so I was renting a room for my buddy's mom. So at that time, there was no internet. So we got the newspaper. I'm looking in the help wanted ads, and I just stumbled across this ad, and it just jumped out at me. It said, outside sales, selling copiers and fax machines, B2B. Now, I had no idea, you know, anything about outside sales. I knew copiers and fax machines, but not enough to be able to sell them. And B2B, Troy, I didn't even know what that meant. But I picked up the phone, broke through, gave him a call. I sat down, had the interview, and there was an owner. The owner's name was Tommy. And Tommy, kind of give you a quick overview on this. You know, like I said, I'm from the East Coast. Tommy was a combination of Joe Pesci and Danny DeVito. So, Tommy didn't say a lot, but he carried a big presence. So I realized pretty quickly that, see, Tommy saw something in me that a lot of people didn't see, and nobody saw at that point. And Tommy actually walked my walk about 15, 20 years before that. He was a kid that was always in trouble. He was a kid from the neighborhood that wasn't supposed to make it. Now he has this thriving business. And when I start to look around and start to see what was going on, I noticed that the ones with the degrees on the wall, the ones that society says are going to make it, and that's the way you should be, actually are working for Tommy. So I thought, you know, that opened my eyes. And then Tommy shed a lot of light, too. He became a mentor. Interesting thing is, if I had Tommy sitting next to me right now, he'd look at me like I had three heads if I told him he was my mentor. He had no idea the impact he made. But long story short, they brought me on as an outside sales rep, and I was working with Tommy one-on-one, and he'd take me out to these businesses and teach me the ropes. So we worked together for about a month and a half, about 2 weeks. And they were grooming me to be an outside sales rep in Center City, Philly. And when you work the high-rises in the city, you start at the top floor and you work your way down. Well, we go all the way to the top floor, go to the penthouse suite, and there's an attorney's firm at this time that was so big that they occupied the top three floors. And this place was beautiful. I mean, it looked like a movie set. Italian marble on the floors, artwork on the walls, a wraparound aquarium, and an actual waterfall right in the entrance of this thing. And it was so big that they had four girls right out front as their receptionist. So we're walking in like we usually do, and I'm following Tommy. I'm just looking around this place, turning around like, man, where in the world are we? We come up to the desk. Hi, can I help you? Looking around, hi, can I help you? I look over, Tommy's gone. I'm shaking.
That's funny.
Hi, can I help you, please? I'm pulling my card out. I go, hi, I'm Dave with she goes, this is gentleman you speak to. Thank you. She takes my card, gives me the other card, gets right back on the phone. I got this card in my hand, Troy. I want to run. My heart's beating out of my chest, but I know that they're all looking at me. So I start walking out. I'm going to the lobby. I'm like, where's Tommy? Where'd Tommy go? There's Tommy leaning next to the elevator. He looks down at the card, looks at me. I go, Tommy, I got the decision maker. I said, what happened? Where were you? He goes, I knew you could do it, kid. So that was my training with Tommy. And Tommy had a little bit of demented sense of humor. He liked to see people squirm. But he taught me that, after working that, I became an outside sales rep for Tommy. And after doing that job, he showed me and taught me that I could walk into any business, any residential house, and walk right in, look them in the eye, shake their hand, and explain and share what I'm doing there and how I can help them. And that's an unbelievable gift, man.
Yeah, I like to dive. That's the part I want to start diving into a little bit more, because a lot of people that like this stuff, they're business-minded people, they're sales entrepreneurship, these kinds of people, like-minded like you and me. And this is stuff that you don't really go more into in this book, because your book's only about fear. But what did he mean when he said you got it, but you did, all you got was a card? So what was the next step? How did you actually make that first sale?
Oh, so when you're an outside sales rep, especially for Tommy's company, you're required to do 40 to 50 cold calls a day. And what that means is you go in and your whole goal is to get to the decision maker. So the first line of defense for these businesses is usually the receptionist, then usually the office manager, and then if she can or he can't make that decision, then it's the next line, the next one in command. So you want to get to the decision maker that's going to be able to say, you know what, we'd like to look at your copiers, we'd like to look at your fax machines. So what happened, the other thing that Tommy taught me is exactly what I said earlier, is how to identify your strengths and back up and enhance your weaknesses. So my strength was creating a relationship, breaking through that, getting to know the receptionist or the office manager, getting to that decision maker. But I really could care less about these copier machines. Sure, I didn't even know how they turned on. I could care less. I'm not a technical guy. I don't care what these things did. It didn't keep my interest. But Tommy saw that, right? So Tommy said, listen, just get the appointment, call us. We'll bring the tech guys out. We'll bring the copier out and let them show how this thing works, and you just keep the relationship going. So we'd have meetings where I'd get the copier in there. The tech guys would show them that it does this, it does that, it flips around, it does a million copies a second, while I'm just keeping the relationship going, and it worked.
Okay, so basically you didn't have to actually make the close of the sale. You just had to get a meeting. You had to get into the open door. You had to set up a meeting with this guy.
No, because you're not going to close the sale just by showing what the copier does. You're going to close the sale by building and keeping a relationship. So building and keeping a relationship is how you open and close a sale, not because you could show them that this copier flips up and down. And that's just a process, man. Mm-hmm. That's just showing you that this is the product we have. But how you close the sale and how you get referrals is relationships.
So you said you did cold calls. What would be an example of maybe a cold call script or something you had done?
There's really no script as far as and I'm talking about physical cold calls, not the phone calls.
Right.
It just pretty much you walk in, you introduce yourself, and you ask for the decision maker. So you give them a card I think my opinion, man, of being in business for myself, and I've always been the salesperson in my businesses. Mm-hmm. I've always brought the business in. I've always been the front guy, and I've always surrounded myself with the people in the back that kept everything together. But I think overall, I think too many people make too big of a deal of sales. And what it really boils down to is this: building relationships, being that people person, but going even a little deeper is, look, at the end of the day, when that person knows that you connect with their needs, mm-hmm. now you got something to really build on. If you go in and you just want to throw up on somebody, you completely shut the door on so much opportunity. And I see so many MLM people doing this.
Absolutely.
They get to a point where you don't even want to pick up the phone when they contact you. You don't even want to text them back when they contact you. You don't want to email them back. You know why? Because it's all about them, and what they're telling you is they don't care about what you want, what you need. They want to throw up on you some more. And I think they're missing a big thing with that. But again, that's just my opinion.
Absolutely, absolutely. And you know, that's why I want to dig into this a little bit more, because I think this is going to be a really, really help to a lot of people if you can give some advice. All right, let's go back to the cold call, all right? I mean, when you have a product, especially when you're like a lot of people and they're struggling, man, I need money, like your thought is like, oh my God, I got to get this sale, because if I don't, they're going to repo my car, right? So as a salesperson,
You already lost.
Yeah. But what?
You already lost. So if that's the mindset, uh-huh. then there's really nothing more to talk about. You already lost. You have to, if you're at that point, mm-hmm. you already lost.
Okay.
So see, everything's energy, man. Everything is energy. That's why personal development, it goes to every pillar of our life, right? Personal, professional, physical, spiritual, all four pillars, personal development completely relates, and it's all about that mindset, the energy. So I didn't mean to cut you off, but
no,
really, I mean, that's my answer, dude, is you already lost if you're there. If you need it, if you need that sale because they're going to repo your car, mm-hmm. then you need to step back and readjust some things actually in your life and figure out why you got to that point, because you're just going to sabotage yourself, man. And really where that's coming from, Troy, that comes from that fear-based mentality.
Right.
When you come from the fear-based mentality, it's never going to be long-term. It's never going to be a winning situation. So you got to figure out how to turn that around, right? And if you are finding yourself in that situation, is your reality at that time, you got to figure out how to change that paradigm into walking in that door, focusing on bringing the most value you can to that person, instead of saying, I need this sale because of me, because of my car, because of my life. So you have to do a paradigm shift, and it has to be real or it's not going to come across.
So in your case of the copters, even if that was a situation because you didn't have a job and that was your first time and you said your heart was pounding and all that. So in reality, that day, that was your situation. But what you're saying is to turn it around, you focus, instead of focus on yourself, you said, all right, instead of me, this lawyer firm, they need this copier because they go through so much paperwork, instead of focusing on your own problems.
Well,
is that what you're saying?
To be honest with you, Troy, back then, would I really, I couldn't articulate it then, but really the reason that I didn't run out of that that office when Tommy left me was simply because my why was big enough. See, I had no money. I had bills right around the corner, and I had to eat. So my why was big enough to get me through the door to the original interview and meet Tommy.
Right.
Now my why became bigger than me because you have to understand, at that point in my life, Tommy was the first successful adult that told me that he believed in me, and he showed me that he believed in me. I'd walked through fire for Tommy at that time. So it wasn't even about, look, they need this copier. It was about there's no way I could let Tommy down. So if you really want to get to the core, they need to figure out their why. And when their why becomes big enough, it's going to pull them through their fear barriers. And when your why becomes bigger than you, now you're going to win every time.
Outstanding. So so you said Tommy gave you some good advice. What are some of the best advice you've ever gotten from other people?
One of the things I always share is I spent a week down in Florida with Bob Proctor back in 2007. And I remember he said to me, he said, son, he said, you don't need to slow down. You just need to calm down. And I take that with me all the time because I'm a very passionate person.
Yeah.
And that's why I am the Monster Motivator. But it's just great advice, man. And that's what he said to me. So, that was awesome. And, throughout the years, I've had some great mentors. And really, it comes down to if you want to win in life consistently, if you want a lot of people are looking for this thing called security, and I think they're looking in the wrong places. Really, if you want the ultimate security, bring the most value. When you bring the most value, you create the most security, and that's just the real.
Absolutely, I agree 1,000%. So who would you say that who are some of your current people you look up to, mentorship, if you will, like people like right now? You say, all right, now when I need advice, I go to this person. Or even a famous person that you follow a lot, who inspires you now?
On a personal note, I have an awesome financial advisor, and I meet with him, and we go over things. And I have an awesome accountant, and he advises me and keeps me in line on things that, again, that's not my strength. I hate that part of business, so I make sure I surround myself with the right people. And then also, when it comes to more celebrity types, I lean towards the people that I feel connected with, and I feel similar messages. And also, I they're not the same people that they were 20 years ago, because I also lean towards and attracted towards the people that are doing it now, right? Versus back in the day, like a Brian Tracy and like a these guys that were before, not so much Bob Proctor because he stays in it, but a lot of these older guys, I don't have a lot of connection with because I don't know that they really understand what's going on today with social media and how it's changed our whole world, and we can build a brand on our own terms, right? A lot of these guys are still stuck in this mode where, in my niche, if you're not in a suit and tie, you're not considered successful. And I think anybody that looks at it that way is really have been having blinders on for the last 8 years. So I love people like Gary Vee. See, Gary Vee to me just
he rocks. Absolutely.
Well, no, but even beyond that, dude, he's created a pathway for people like me and you. And so many of the masses that have that short attention span, have that high energy, and he made it okay to say, you know what, turn that camera on and roll with it, real, raw, and live. And he's been a huge inspiration for me with Monster Motivator TV. When I look back at Wine Library TV, and I look back at the things he's done. So Gary V, I love Grant Cardone. Here's what I love about Grant Cardone. I don't even know that I'd even, you know, who knows? I don't drink alcohol, but I'm just saying, who knows if I'd ever sit down and have a beer with him. I don't know if we connect on that level. But here's the golden nuggets that I've got from Grant Cardone, and they're genius, man. They're fucking genius.
I love Grant Cardone. He's awesome.
ACA.
Yeah.
You know what that is?
No. Go ahead and tell me.
ACA. I would even suggest people write this down.
Okay.
And this pertains directly to your brand, to your marketing, to social media, to everything you need to do to build your brand. ACA. Attention. Criticism. Admiration.
Oh, absolutely.
All day long. Attention.
Right.
Criticism. Admiration. The other thing I got from Grant Cardone, another unbelievable gold nugget from the 10X, omnipresent, baby. Omnipresent. You need to be everywhere at all times. If you can't support your brand, then why would you ever think anybody else is going to support your brand and promote your brand? That means there's something that you're lacking. Either the belief in yourself, the belief in your product, the belief in your brand. And that all maps to one thing.
Could you go into that a little bit more?
Message, Troy, my whole message maps to one thing. It's not just fear barriers. It's not just leadership. You know what it maps to? It maps to your self-image. See, you can build your self-image up. You can tear it down, but you cannot outperform it. So, Grant Cardone, those two gold nuggets, I'll take with me to the grave. It's so spot on.
All right, hey, I got a comment. Somebody actually wrote it down. Marion Sethan Evans wrote ACA. So thank you, Marion, for on that.
Wait a minute. That's my monster moderator. Marion, yeah. Thank you for jumping on.
All right,
monster
yeah.
moderator. She does our moderating for Monster Motivator TV. Awesome lady. Just has a book out, and she can post that information on there as well. Awesome lady. What a complete monster mode. Love her. Marion, thank you for jumping on. What was her comment?
I just said ACA. When you said write it down, she must have did just that. So
attention, criticism, admiration. And Marion, if you can, put those next to those letters. This way people see it. But think about this, Troy, right?
Yes.
You want you're going to get out there and blow your brand up, so you're going to create a lot of attention. And then you're going to create criticism because you're out there. And if you're not sure how accurate that is, just look at the celebrities. Look at the sports figures, right?
You got to go out and get some haters. Right. Get those haters out there.
Right. But understanding you're going to get that because you're getting the attention. And if you follow through and you have a real legitimate product, program, or brand, you are eventually going to get the admiration. And the other thing that the other guy I really love, man, he's not at the level of Grant Cardone yet, but he's almost there. He's getting there. Sean Whalen. This guy's message, man, is just so, so awesome. So connect. I just love that guy's message. And he talks about your haters being your biggest fans. They just don't know it yet. And I love that, man. It's because think about it. The reason that they're hating on you so much is because you're on their radar. Your life is completely taking over their world. So they're actually fans. They just don't know how to express it.
I want to talk about haters just for a moment. You know, I once saw this study. I heard an audiobook. I don't remember which one. I can't annotate it because I don't remember which one it was because it was years ago. But I heard this study, and they were talking about Howard Stern. Now, I don't know if you know this. And a lot of people don't know this, but Howard Stern is a billionaire because he gets paid in stock of XM Radio. He's literally like the majority owner.
Yep.
I mean, he must be the highest paid DJ in the world because he's literally a billionaire DJ. Anyway, what's so funny is that even before that, when he was just before he got the contract with all them and all that, and he was just a regular DJ on the air growing his brand, there was a study done about the people and Howard Stern, right? And they did, you know, millions of people was in this study. A radio company did study, you know, for airtime and how much to charge to advertise on that. So they were just trying to figure out the interest. So they asked about Howard Stern. They said, Now, here's the funny and interesting fact. They said the people that said they loved Howard Stern, his fans, the people said, yeah, man, I love that guy. I love his show. They said they would listen to him for about an hour a day, right? The funny thing was, the people that said, I can't stand Howard Stern, the haters, right? I don't like what he talks about, right? The people that said they hated Howard Stern said that they would listen to him for 3 hours a day. And yeah. So that when they asked both parties why, you know, so they asked the fans and said, well, you listen to Howard Stern, why do you listen to him for a whole hour? You know, the people that said they loved him. And they said, well, I listened to him for a whole hour because I can't wait to see what he's going to say next, right? The funny thing was when they asked the haters, the people said, man, if you hate this guy, why do you listen to him for 3 hours? And they said the same answer. They said, because I can't wait to see what he's going to say next. And that was so, it was a funny and interesting outcome. And I think that's relevant to everyone in every business with all that, you know. Like, look at the Kardashians, yep. You know. They don't even really have a talent or a product. They're not even really actors or singers. But yet, they got the most publicity everywhere, mainly because of the haters.
Yeah, and you know, and that's exactly it. And Howard Stern is the ultimate example. I mean, I'm from Philly, so he came in and just dominated that market like nobody else, man. And just put a guy out that people were listening, that we grew up listening to, and he just crushed them. You know why? To understand why Howard Stern was so successful. You know, because he kept it so real, man. And people are starving for real. Whether you like him or not, it has nothing to do with it. That's a big reason why Trump made such an impact, man, because he says things that people want to say, but they're afraid to say it. Mm-hmm. And I just did a post last night about the, you know, about the people, they think they want the truth, and then when you give them the truth, then they demonize it.
Yeah, yeah. There's always those Monday morning quarterbacks all the time. Hey, we're getting long in this interview. I'm gonna. I got a few other questions I want to ask. So let's go. Let's move along. Let's see here. Who would you? I know you do interviews all the time. You just finished season one of 2016, Monster Motivator, and I know you got a really. You've been doubling up on the work on 2017 already. I mean, it took me about 14 days just to get this interview with you because I know you've been really punching it out, and I know you even like me. So that's weird that I know you're really busy. So. What are your plans with this thing? I know you keep talking about this on tour. What is that going to involve? What cities are you going to go to? Is there anybody traveling with you on this tour? Other motivators?
Actually, yeah, some cool.
Is there going to be a listing, or is there something that I can show or display in reference to that?
We got some cool things coming up. We they're all in the work. We're getting ready to do a probably less than a month. We're going to be launching an actual real webinar. Series, so I'm excited about that. I have a program that's actually called Knockout Fear in the First Round as well, a digital program. It's a 14-lesson program with a video for each lesson and audio, MP3 audio, and then a downloadable workbook. So we're going to be doing that along with my ebook and then that kind of stuff and offering some workshops, some actual live in-person workshops. But Monster Motivator TV, we're getting geared up to, and I'm in talks with some production companies about doing some pilots for a reality show, and ultimately what Monster Motivator TV reality show really encompasses, what it combines is three successful reality shows that have already been on the air, and the first one is The Home Makeover. You know, back in the day when they did the before and afters, and you saw everything throughout this when the family didn't have the money to, mm-hmm. to get a new home,
right.
And they came in and they redid the home, and then you got to hear the story. And they shared their struggle. It's that Triple D, my man Guy Fieri, going from restaurant to restaurant all over the country. That's part of the concept of Monster Motivator TV. And third, last but not least, is my boys from Tap Out, you know, going from town to town, recruiting sponsors, fighters for their MMA apparel, and doing it on a tour bus. So those three successful reality shows are what a combination of what I see Monster Motivator TV being, and that's going from town to town and creating the Oprah effect, if you will, when we come into your town and we highlight your business and we share your story and I pull those gold nuggets out, it's going to take you, your company, your nonprofit to a whole nother level. And that's what I mean by Monster Motivator TV Mania Tour coming to a town near you, man. We're in the works, man. We're in the works, and we'll keep everyone posted.
You're going to all 50 states? What's your plan with that for round one?
I'd love to, but we're still in the planning mode. But we'll see how long each interview and each process takes. But we're still in the planning mode. But that's we're moving pretty quickly, man.
Okay. All right. Awesome. So that'll be coming out. What about that webinar? When do you expect that to be ready for everyone that's hungry for that information?
What's today's date?
It's the 12th. 12th. Yes.
12th. So probably we're shooting for about a month from now.
Okay.
And we'll keep everyone posted too. I have an awesome team that we put together and so yeah, man, we're excited.
All right. So who would you, if you had somebody big to interview, who would you like to interview? Name, if you could name some people that you really would want to grab.
Yeah, I don't have it in front of me, but I have a list of,
like, a wish list. You know,
I have a list of over 75 people, man. Mm-hmm. And as far as people that are celebrities mm-hmm. and other people know is what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. But to be honest with you, Troy, I get so much joy and so much fulfillment and so much energy and so much passion from those Rocky stories, man. Alex Montoya that was born with no arms, one leg, and has his own business, has an author of 3 books, worked for the San Diego Padres full time, and just gets the shit done without any excuses. That's what gets my juices flowing. When I have somebody on like Amy Kardashian, not Kardashian, Kardashian, that was born in Syria, and at 12 years old, their country was in war, and she's living in a cave with her 6-year-old brother trying to figure out how they're going to eat for the next day, and doing that for 3 months straight and being separated from her family, and then get reacclimated with the family after 6 months, and then coming to the United States, learning the language, dyslexic, having a little girl, and everyone telling her that she's too dumb to do anything, and now she's operated multiple businesses and is very successful. So that's what gets my juices flowing, man.
Wow, that's an outstanding story. That's even better than probably you or me, man. If you go from something like that and to that
probably.
Level, that's
Are you
just
kidding me, Troy.
Wow.
Troy, when I'm talking to her, this interview went an hour and a half. I could have went in another 3 hours. You know what I'm saying to myself when she's telling me this?
Yeah.
I'm embarrassed.
Yes.
I'm embarrassed for what I was complaining about.
Right.
This is like, she's as badass as you can get. She's the real deal. This lady, she is badass. So I'm looking at that like, are you kidding me? Jesus, man, I'm complaining about what? She said she'd actually watch her little brother, 6-year-old little brother, go through the trash to try and eat because the government would drop off bread every once in a while. Mm. She said when she found herself in the United States, she's standing in a grocery store and she sees people in line with carts full of food, upset because they have to wait in line, and she's going, what?
Yeah,
what?
I hear you.
So yeah, dude, she makes us look like we don't even deserve what we have. That's what she makes us look like, dude. We have no clue.
Absolutely.
What it's really about. So anyway, that puts things in perspective for me real quick. That checks me real quick.
Absolutely. That's outstanding. So, you say you collaborate with a lot of people. What do you look for in somebody that you work with to collaborate with, and what are the kind of people that you avoid? You said, man, I just can't work with these kinds of people. So, what do you look for, and what do you avoid in collaborators?
A lot of times, I look for the synergy, and I look for especially if they enhance my weaknesses, so then I could double down on my strengths, and we have that synergy and can work together. And who I have zero time for is excuse makers. and flaky people and people that don't want to lace their boots up and get to work, and the sideline chirpers, the ones that have all the answers but are scared to death to get on the field. That's why I have zero time for them. They just they take up everyone's time, and they should just get out of the way.
Okay, that's good. That's good. Now, I noticed that you're into health, man. You said you work out early in the morning. I mean, before the sun comes up, you're working out.
Yeah.
And that's and for me, that's way early because I'm on the East Coast and you're on the West Coast, so you're really early for me. But, you know, I know you said you're all into health, you know, diet. You said you even had a health store. Have you ever thought about actually, like, pushing your own health products or being, you know, the sponsor of some health products and
diet plan? That's definitely on the radar, rolling out some lines of nutritional products down the road for sure. And I've been an athlete my whole life. I'm always been that physical guy, and I and the gym is my zen. That's my centering. That's where I get so much great ideas, and it just gets me ready for the day. And I like the way it makes me feel even after. And my goal in life is to always turn the clock back. Whatever I can do, I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't gamble. I tell people I'm as boring as you can get, but I wouldn't want it any other way. And I loved it to figure out how to turn the clock back. That's why I admire a guy so much like Sylvester Stallone, man, that you know, at 70 years old, the way he looks and everything he's done, there's a guy that's definitely on my list. And there's a guy that you know, and especially I'm a kid from Philly too, so it goes a little deeper than that. You know, that's always my goal, man, is to turn the clock back. And if I can share with people and teach them how to do that with nutritional products or with a mindset or a combination, don't get any better than that for me.
Okay, right now what I'm doing is just going to pause you off for a second, and then I want to show people a little a review of your book. Let me click on the I had it set up now. Click on the link. You can watch it along on your other device. Click through here, go to the website. All right, now this is Dave Daisy. If those are watching, this is where you can order your book. That's where I got one through Audible right here. There's different prices and there's ways to get it, but what I wanted to come down, you can get a little preview of the book here, what he talks about. But I want to show you that this guy is the real deal. You look, he's got so many 5-star comments, reviews. I mean, it just goes on for days of 5 stars, myself included. You know, I'm just going to read some of these off real quick, Dave. I don't know if you can still listen in. But it says, Monster Motivator Dave Daley does not disappoint. You know, he loved this book. Must read this book. He's on fire. Unstoppable. You know, retellable. A great story from a guy who knows what he's talking about. There's a video here. I'm going to play this real quick.
Hey everybody, Johnny Storm here from Live to Win Now. I want to turn you on to a really good book written by one of our guests and one of our friends of this program. I'll Knock Out Fear in the First Round. This is the Kindle version that I've got on my iPad here, as you see. And it's written by Dave Daley, the Monster Motivator. So, the way the light's reflecting in the office today doesn't really give you a good view, but Knock Out Fear in the First Round. And one of the things I really love is the first, very first chapter. Truth be told, I'm not supposed to be here. And that's true for yours truly, too. I'm not supposed to be here. I've been through a lot of my life, and a lot of it self-inflicted. You know, but when I look back and I think of some of the things that I've done and seen and experienced, I shouldn't be here either. So you'll have to read the book to find out why Dave says he shouldn't be here. But trust me when I say, if you have any fears, if you have a lot of doubts and fears, this book will help you eliminate those. And believe me, speaking from personal experience, fear is one of the worst things you can face in life, in business, in general. Fear keeps you held back. Fear can make you depressed. Fear can immobilize you. And in most cases, 99% of the time, the fears are unfounded and irrational. We make up stuff in our minds about worst case scenarios so often, and that's what holds us back. And once again, yours truly is guilty of that as anybody. So if you want to knock out fear and you want to do it right away in the first round, get a hold of Dave's book here, and I'll show it to you again. I've got the Kindle version, but he is sending me my very own paperback version. So get this on Amazon.com. Just type in Dave Daley, D-A-L-E-Y, and you'll find the book.
I'm just going to pause it there, Dave. I just wanted to get back on that. Now, I don't know if you heard that. Did you hear all that, Dave?
Yeah, man. That's my boy, Johnny. I was on his podcast a few times. Awesome, awesome guy. And he's as real as it gets as well. That's why we created that synergy, man. And just a great guy, man.
I just want to know what your thoughts of, man. I mean, I don't know, how it is on rank, but I mean, you got all these 5-star rankings over and over and over and over, and unlike most people, you know, those aren't, you know, where you had to pay somebody to get this going. I mean, you've really pushed this thing out there and let people know, and you keep growing. Like when I first talked to you, I mentioned to you that you didn't have an Audible. I was mad at you about it, and then I think probably the next day you probably went and made an Audible and uploaded it in a very short time and made it accessible for people like me who want to get the audio version, which I think has probably helped you out. I hope so.
Oh yeah, and it was always in the plans. It just, you know, like anything, like, you know, when I decided to write the book and I connected with Kelly, my publisher, I'm a momentum guy. I'm all in or all out. And we actually, I didn't write one word of this book. I audioed everything. Everything I audioed and emailed it to her. And then she put it together in text. So that audio that you're listening to is just me, real raw, and given that's what I gave to Kelly. And I'm very, very humbled. And very, very proud of the feedback from a lot of the people with the book, and I'm really, I'm very, very humbled, excited, and proud of the feedback we've gotten from Monster Motivator TV. We started doing that in 2016 in March, and we did 106 episodes from March to January 1. And when we were writing the book, we were doing the book. I wanted the last chapter to be Monster Motivator TV, so now it's a stepping stone, a jump-off point for my next book, which will be Monster Motivator TV. So we were trying to figure out what content to put in there, and so me and Kelly, I said, well, how about if I reach out and see if we can, if anybody has any testimonials? Well, I reached out, and we got enough testimonials to fill a whole chapter and then some. We weren't even able to put everything in there. And then we did a book signing in SoCal here. And I don't know, Troy, there was probably about 30, 40 people that showed up, and about 15 of them were actually on the show before. And I never did a book signing before, so my assistant said, what do we do? I said, I have no idea. Let's just figure it out as we go. Like, I do a lot of things, and what I did was I just started inviting people up to give their uncandid, real take and testimonial on Monster Motivator TV and their experience before, during, and after. And we have it on video, and it's absolutely just so humbling and amazing when, you know, you have somebody say, you know what, I was scared to death of sharing my story, and then we went on the show. It was almost like therapy for some people, and now it's actually changed them to the point where now they're okay with sharing their story. Now they're embracing their story, and they're moving forward, and they're building their businesses. Or I had another guy, that Larry Lewis, that was a personal trainer for a big gym. He came on, and a few weeks later, he started his own company and doing boot camps and doing his own personal training. And then I had him on for a follow-up. And so those kind of things are what get my juices flowing, and very, very humble.
Oh, that's awesome. I mean, that's just awesome. So basically, you started not even a year ago with this whole venture, with this online thing, with this book. What did you do before that, and why the transition?
Well, I started Dave Daley Monster Motivator about 15 months ago. And I've been, personal development's been in my life and affected my life the last 17, 18 years. And I love to share this information. And I've I've been an entrepreneur my whole adult life. I've built and sold three companies in three different industries, and I've crashed a few as well, and all that. I decided that I still have a own and operate a fire restoration business out here in Southern California as well, but I wanted to start to move down that direction. And I love platform speaking. I love keynote speaking, and I love the live interaction. So we started to build the brand towards that. And we were building the brand towards Dave Daley, the Monster Motivator, and I was going to be the that keynote corporate speaker and be that road warrior and travel all over the country and eventually the world and doing keynotes. But after we did the second Monster Motivator episode, it just became my oxygen, became everything for me. So we started to shift, and now everything's based around this show. And it's just been an awesome journey so far, man. And we just got these wheels started. So we're excited.
So let me talk about that for a minute. So you see, you have a fire restoration business, right? That's like heavy labor type of work, correct?
Yeah, but I don't, my company, I subcontract out. So we don't do the actual, some of my guys do the physical labor, but overall we subcontract things out.
Right, but it's help me and help the people watching, right? You're into this heavy labor job set once again. I mean, even though you own the company, right? Mindset, job set, if you will. How do you go from that to being a keynote speaker? How did that shift hand? And talk about the first keynote presentation that you gave.
Well, it really comes down to just sharing real life stories and real life experiences based on real world wisdom. And that's why I tend to be a good storyteller, and I'm very passionate, and people seem to relate to that and connect with it. So for me, it was just a very simple transition. That's why my very first business was a public adjusting firm, where a public adjuster is licensed and bonded in the state to represent the homeowner against the insurance company. And I built a firm for 5 years and sold that, then had a fire restoration business after that, right after that, and had that for 7 years, sold that, came out to Southern California, and bought a struggling sports nutrition store, and we built that up in 4 years and built enough equity and flipped that. And then I had a restaurant for a while out here in SoCal, and then got back into personal development and building this brand. And I also, 2013, I opened another fire restoration business. So I'm a big believer, Troy, it's not what you do, it's how you do it.
I think what I'm trying to get to here is help the young people, help people that want to be in also this line of work, who think they can help and motivate. You know, how did you get that first gig as a motivational speaker?
Well, you just got to go out and pound the pavement, man. Do the cold calling, get in front of the event planners, and put together a game plan. That's all you got to. And you got to, when you say young, it's also very important that, look, if you're a 20, and I know Gary Vee talks about this and some other people, because they're right on. You know, when you're a 20-something year old kid that wants to be a life coach, but you have no life experience, you know, that's what's going to come back and bite you. Because how much value can you bring? How authentic can you really bring when you can't pull from real world stuff? So just figure out what your strengths are and get yourself out there. And now you really, there's no excuses, because we have all these platforms, right? Live streaming, live stream on Facebook, live stream on Instagram, Snapchat blows up, Instagram stories. It's just, the platform's unbelievable to get your message out there. YouTube. Mm-hmm. You just got to get out there, man. You just got to get out there and give as much value as you can.
All right, we've been going, I think, over an hour now, so I'm just going to cut it short, because the videos are hard to upload when you get longer than that. So maybe what we'll do is we'll have another interview maybe later on a different platform where we can actually see each other. I saw this other thing yesterday from Philip Lopez. I want to give him a shout-out, because without him, I wouldn't even have this program to be able to do this. So I learned that. And so anybody who's interested, click through. There's a link on the Motivation and Inspiration page to get Dave Daley's book. As well as to follow any of his content. He also publishes there, and follow Monster Motivator. You got any final words before we do it your style out?
Yeah, at the end of the end of the day, it's just understanding that tomorrow's not guaranteed for any of us. And if you live a full life, the 80s, 90s, it's over so quickly. And we don't get this time back. So do what you got to do to make this an unbelievable journey for yourself.
All right, thank you, Dave. You want to do that? Roar!
Three baby monster motivator roar. Make it count.
Ah! All right, thanks, Dave.
Thanks, brother.
All right, that was Dave Daley, Monster Motivator, and you guys have a great day.